So optimization as a field is largely connected to operations research. So operations research is a field of applied mathematics that's been around since around the First World War and basically dealt with optimizing processes in supply chains, factories, etc. So how many workers should you have in an assembly line in order to maximize the production of weapons? I think a good introduction to optimization can take place through some toy problems, which are basically benchmarks for any kind of optimization algorithm. Whereas these problems might seem simple, in reality, they're quite complicated. Some of them might even have exponential complexity. And solving this problem successfully through an algorithm means that you can then apply this algorithm to more complicated cases. So to give you an example, traveling salesman problem is one of the most famous problems, maybe the most famous problem in optimization. So you are, let's say, a salesman that goes across the country, let's say the United States, and you need to visit all the cities in a catalog, but without going through the same city twice. And at the same time, you also need to optimize your time. Okay, so you need to do this as fast as possible, or the distance. I mean, in this case, it's basically the same goal. So this is a problem which looks fairly simple, but in reality, it's very complicated to solve. Well, whereas this looks like a toy problem, this obviously relates to real-life problems in supply chain, vehicle routing, optimizing flows, etc. Another similar toy problem which has extensions in the real world is the knapsack problem. So basically, the knapsack problem, you want to maximize value while minimizing the weight. So you have a bag, and in this bag can only hold items up to a certain weight, but also each item has a value. So you need to find the right combinations of items in order to maximize the value and minimize the weight. It's easy to see how this would relate in many other real-life problems where you have a limited budget and you have to optimize your resources in order to allocate them in the best possible way. For example, this could directly be applied in human resources, to give you an example. It could also apply to other things such as choosing the right marketing titles. I mean, the examples are countless. This basically demonstrates how from these toy problems we can expand to real-world use cases. So there are many optimization algorithms, and it's quite a technical topic. I don't expect someone who's non-technical to know most of these algorithms, but it's still good to expose the basic ideas, at least to get you familiar with some of the terms. And I mean, some people might disagree with this categorization, but what I like to break down optimization algorithms in two families. One is what I call like the standard mathematical routines from applied maths, things such as linear programming and integer programming, and nonlinear optimization, and then meta-heuristics, okay? So the standard routines are basically methods which largely came from operations research. They have a good mathematical background. They're very transparent as to what they do. And usually they also are accompanied by some theoretical guarantees, okay, so that you know, this method is going to find an optimum in a finite number of steps, etc. So these methods have been around for many decades. They have been applied successfully in many problems, and you can also find them in all standard optimization packages. Meta-heuristics is a newer trend developed around the 80s and 90s, and this basically describes methods which are inspired. I mean, this field was largely inspired by genetic algorithms, which used a genetic analogy, the theory of evolution, in order to solve optimization problems. So the difference with the standard routines are that meta-heuristics are a bit more like black boxes. Essentially, what we're looking at here is similar to the differences between machine learning and statistics, where standard routines have a better mathematical foundation. Meta-heuristics can be very, very powerful, like black boxes, like machine learning models, but their foundations and their assumptions are a bit shaky at best. So they're not always the preferred method, even if they can work quite well in practice, because it's not that easy to understand what they're doing. So genetic algorithms, I mean, even though they are hard to understand, I think they still deserve a special mention here, because it's probably the best method that you can use if you have no idea what else to do. So the good thing with genetic algorithms is that you can apply them in any problem, and they're also very easy to parallelize, which now that you have cloud computing capabilities, this is very important. However, this is where the problems start. They contain some random components, so you might have to run them many, many times in order to find out whether they arrive to a good solution or not. I mean, it's not easy to discuss about all the differences between, you know, linear programming, integer programming, and genetic algorithms, but it's still good to mention the basics of how these things work. And in this image here, you can see this evolutionary analogy. So genetic algorithms go through an evolutionary process of selecting the best solutions, crossover, which means they basically breed the solutions, they mix them together, it's as if the solutions have children, then they mutate them, and then they evaluate them. And they go through this cycle again and again through generations of solutions. So how to run optimization algorithms? You can find optimization routines in all standard packages. You have commercial packages such as MATLAB. You have SciPy, which has all the standard linear, integer programming, and non-linear optimization methods such as BFTS, which you can find. SciPy stands for Scientific Python, open source library for Python. There are also libraries in R. For example, I mentioned here the app, which is a library for genetic algorithms and evolutionary computation in Python. I mean, it doesn't matter whether you go for a commercial solution or an open source, there are countless choices. And these algorithms have been around for decades, so it probably doesn't really matter what package you choose as long as you're familiar with it. There are not going to be that many differences between the packages. This was a brief overview of the different methods and techniques, but let's come back to our topic, right? So you are a decision maker within your organization, you're a CEO, a founder, you're a product manager, it doesn't matter. What you care about is not the exact algorithm behind, let's say, the simplest method. What you care about is how you can apply this to your problems. So the first thing to basically do is work with these three heuristics I'm giving you, right? I think optimization problems are, once you get into this optimization mindset, it's easy to start detecting optimization problems. The first thing that you should ask yourself is, are you in a situation where you care about the resources? You know, do you have limited resources and you're trying to make the most of them? If the answer is yes, then it is very likely you are facing an optimization problem. Then another question to ask yourself, are you trying to minimize something? Most likely time or cost. And finally, do you try to maximize something? Maybe profit or time spent on a page, sales, whatever. So just ask yourself these three questions. If the answer is yes to any one of those three, then you're most likely facing an optimization problem and not just a predictive modeling or statistical modeling problem. So finally, some things to be aware of before you actually move forward with your optimization projects. The first thing to be aware of is that global optima in the real world are rarely guaranteed. Okay? So what I mean by this, there are many possible solutions to an optimization problem. Okay, most of these solutions will be what we call local optima. This means there are solutions that are good enough, but they're not the best. So finding a global optimum is basically the holy grail of optimization, right? But for some optimization problems, you can find it. For some others, there's no guarantee you're going to find it, irrespective of what method you are going to use. And there are actually some reasons why this happens. So it's good to be aware of that, that just because you run optimization routine, it doesn't mean you're going to find the best solution out there automatically. And obviously, the choice of method is going to have a huge effect on the quality of the solution you find. So different methods work better at different problems. Then something else to be aware of is that optimization algorithms can be very sensitive to the parameters you feed into them. Okay, so you need to be able to formulate two things clearly. The first one is the objective function, and the second one is the constraints. So what I mean by the objective function, this is the thing that you're optimizing. So in some cases, it'd be very simple, right? So if, for example, you're a retailer, you're trying to optimize sales, this can be fairly simple. However, in other cases, it can be a bit more complicated. And slight differences in the objective function can make the algorithm go completely haywire. So this is usually the case when you have multi-objective optimization problems. So these are problems when you try to do two or three things at the same time, right? So you're trying, for example, to minimize cost and at the same time maximize profit. Or if you have weighted variables, if you have, let's say, five, six different types of resources, let's say the hospital scenario, you have doctors and nurses and ambulances, and somehow these all interact with each other. And in this case, it's a slight change to the objective function. For example, the waiting time could make the algorithm perform completely differently. To drill down a bit further into this example, if, for example, you describe waiting time as hours, you might get a different result to if you basically were counting time in minutes. So numerical differences, conceptual differences, they can give you a completely different solution. And the second thing about the constraints are things such as your budget, the available resources. You also need to be very careful with the formulation of all these parameters, because optimization algorithms, they will might find a solution which is not feasible, right? So if, for example, you don't provide the constraint around the total number of doctors that can be in the hospital, then maybe an optimization routine would find that, look, if you have a million doctors in the hospital, then waiting times will reach zero. You see these things happening quite often, and you see engineers quite often missing out on important variables. This is why this optimization project needs to go through an iteration life cycle. Then you need to do sanity checks with the decision makers within the organization to make sure that the results make sense. And this is why it's important to have an experienced data scientist who also understands the domain, right? Who they also understand what the resources actually represent. They understand the weights between the different resources, which ones are more important, and the weights between the different goals. And finally, you need to be aware, as I mentioned, of the differences between predictive analytics and optimization. You need to be aware that you might be solving two problems instead of one. And the quality of your predictive or the statistical model is going to affect the performance of your optimization model. So if you have, let's say, a model that can predict waiting times in a hospital, it can predict sales, but the performance is, you know, let's say 70% instead of 90%, then the optimization algorithm will do as best as it can. But when you actually try to deploy this in the real world, you might find the results a bit disappointing. So you have to treat this as two separate projects, building the predictive or the statistical model and building the optimization model. That was the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed this video discussing about the differences between predictive analytics, optimization, and exposing some of the basic algorithms and problems in optimization. Make sure to visit our page at TESSERACT.academy and also join our channel on YouTube. So that was Stelios from the TESSERACT Academy, and I hope to see you again in another one of our videos. Thank you.